Hello, everybody. I'm going here to talk about how to write multimedia applications with Grilo. In this talk, I will see two use cases, two examples, which is Totem and the new gnome music. So I'm going to explain how these two applications are using Grilo, what are the problems they are trying to solve, and how Grilo helps. Later, I will also talk about a couple of new use cases that people can have when they implement their application. So yes, let's start with an introduction. So basically, when you're writing a multimedia application, one of the things you need to solve is how I get access to the content, right? There are some times that the content is on local disk, but other times the content is on some web service, you know? Basically, each web service has its own API. So for instance, in the case of YouTube, you have a very clear specification of the API. So when you are writing an application for YouTube, you take that API and you write your application, right? The problem is when you want your application to get access to other several sources at the same time. For instance, you want to play content from YouTube and also from Vimeo. So if you check each source or web service have a different API. Even when you want to do it seems quite simple, like, okay, search for videos or list all the videos available. But even though, so you need to write different APIs. This is becomes worse when you try to integrate more information from other sources. For instance, let's say you are writing your multimedia, your media player application. You are playing a song, and you want to show, for instance, the lyrics of the song, or you are implementing a set-top box when you get content from any place that stores movies, and now you want to show information about the movie, like the title or who is the director or this kind of information, or even subtitles. So basically, you need to go to this service. Each one provides a different API, and you need to integrate everything in your application. This is done for all applications. I mean, what one user does for one application, another must do also for a different application. So you know, there are no sharing of this knowledge or this structure. So ideally, there should be just a common API. I mean, for instance, YouTube, Vimeo, and all those services use the same API. So that we ideally have a really simple way of integrating more information. You know, when I add new information, for instance, I have there are the subtitles, but I could have another service that provides, cover arts for your music, or biography for your main favorite artist. So how to make this more easier to do? So here is where Grilo tries to help. Basically, Grilo is a framework that is very focused on making discovery of content and getting access to the content quite simple. And it does because it provides a single high-level API to access all the sources of information. So for instance, when you're using Grilo and you get access to YouTube, the API is exactly the same, like getting access, for instance, for Vimeo, or getting access to Flickr, for instance, or getting access to even your local disk, right? So basically, it's a matter of supporting or more sources in your program. And the other part is that Grilo provides a way of being extended. All the sources are actually plugins that developers can write separately of your program. You can plug them in your system, and you automatically are starting using that. So for instance, if I now write, a plugin for Dailymotion, it will be easy to integrate in my application because it will use the same API like YouTube and so on. So just a rough view of the main concepts of Grilo. As I was saying, there are three concepts involved in how Grilo works. The first one is the source. Sources are basically the source of information, right? For instance, YouTube or Jamendo or your IMDb database. Okay, so it's the wrapper that gets access to the content of information that is out there. The second one is are the media content, the audio, the video, and the image, right? Because right now it's mostly these three types of media that Grilo handles, because at the end, Grilo handles only multimedia content. So basically, what is a media? I mean, what is a video? Actually, video, you can see a video like a hash table or a dictionary that is formed by metadata keys, right? Which is in this, in the right. Basically, for instance, a video could be formed by a title, for instance, by the author of the video, the URL where the video is located, you have to play it. It can have things like, is it favorite or not? I mean, a lot of information that you can provide. So basically, the combination is that media actually contains basically metadata keys, right? So basically, when you are providing an audio content, this audio is defined by the keys it has. For instance, the title, an artist, or album, or all the information we want to add to it. And the sources, basically, they create this media. Actually, they have two roles. One of them is creating the media. For instance, the YouTube plugin creates video content, right? And this YouTube basically defines which kind of information can handle. For instance, it can say, okay, I'm able to handle the URL, I'm able to handle the title, handle the artist, or such information. There are, nevertheless, other sources that actually don't create content. But what they do is, with content coming from another sources, I can inject new information. For instance, the IMDb, right? IMDb means that the way that IMDb works is, okay, if I have a video, and the video, I know it's a movie, I can provide you all the information that IMDb can provide to me. So I go to IMDb, I get all the information, I enrich the content of the of this media, right? So basically, it's the way in Grilo it works. So how to use it, I'm going to show, two use cases. Totem is one of the best use cases because it fits quite well with what Grilo is able to provide. So let's see. So basically, in Totem, it has a plugin for Grilo to use Grilo to get content from different places, right? Basically, I have put here some of the sources that Totem is able to read, like, for instance, video from Vimeo, from YouTube, from a UMP server, or even for your local disk. Right. And then there are, I'm sorry, it doesn't seem very well, but basically these are two screenshots of Totem. You can run it. The first one is the browse view in Totem. It's appearing in one of the options. Basically, it allows you to browse through the content that is provided by one of the sources. For instance, you select YouTube, and you can open the tree and browse through it. Right. The other one is basically a view for searching content. It provides you a text field where you can enter the title of the video or what you want to search. For instance, in this case, I think it's searching GUADEC in YouTube, and it provides information. In this case, it's using the thumbnail of information, then the title and the author of that video, right? So basically, when you are using Grilo to write Totem, in this case, for this plugin, there are some things that you need to have in mind. The first is what you want to show. I mean, I'm going to show only videos, only music. That depends on your application. There are applications that can handle, for instance, music and audio. I think Totem was doing that in that way on the past. Now it's moving just to show only video because it's centering on video content. So basically, you need to define what you want to show. And then you need to define which information I want to have there for that, because there are a lot of information, but I don't want to use all the information. So in this case, for instance, in Grilo, there are up to 55 different type of information you can handle. Even sources can extend those information. Sources can provide new type of information that can be added to this core of keys, right? So some of them are, for instance, the URL, the title, the thumbnail, so on. So in the case of Totem, the rules are I only want to show the videos, right? So basically, it means that when I use Grilo, all sources come up and say, hey, I'm here, I'm available. So what Totem does is, okay, it checks what kind of information is the source able to provide. So for instance, if it can't provide videos, I'm not interested in it, so I just ignore it. For instance, if the Flickr source comes up and say, okay, I'm only able to handle, for instance, the image, okay, I ignore it. So I'm not going to handle it, use that source. Okay. Then, for those videos, those sources that provide videos, I need to check what I'm doing. So if I'm implementing the browse view, what I want is only those sources that provides the browse feature, right? And it's because all sources in Grilo decides which of the features they can implement. So there are sources that implement the searching, others that that implement the browse, others that implement other operations. So basically, you can check what of those operations are implemented. The reason why some operations are implemented and others not, is because at the end, the source is just a wrapper of the web service. So if you have a web service that, for instance, doesn't provide a search, it doesn't make sense for you to implement the search, because the only way to implement that is, you know, caching all the information in your hard disk and search there. And that's totally inefficient. So in Grilo, the sources doesn't try to do more things that actually the web service is providing. So in this case, for instance, I'm implementing my browse view. So I check, okay, do you handle the browse? No, okay, I ignore you. In the case of search, I do the same for the search feature. I check, okay, does this source provide the search? Yes, okay, I will show it I will use it in my application. So given that, here I write, okay, I'm going to use here the browse, and now I'm going to use here the search. The other thing I need to set, as I say, is what kind of information I want to handle, actually. So for instance, in the case of a search, as you can see, I think it's not very well shown, but if you run Totem and perform a search, you will see that in besides the thumbnail, which is something that you can see, below is the title of the video and the outro of the video. So that's kind of what I want to show. Actually, I want to handle the URL because at the end I want to play it, so I also want to handle the URL. But there are a lot of other information I want to show. You know, for instance, if I have a GPS information on my content, I don't want to use it, so I discard it. Or if I have, for instance, any other key like favorites or size of the video or mime type, whatever other information, I don't want to use it. So as you see, in the case of search, I'm defining the information I want to use. And if you take a look at the browse, basically, I'm not showing the author because at the end, this view is only showing the title and just the duration. So basically, I don't care about author, I don't care about file. So I'm not going to ask for it. So basically, with this information, when you implement, this is just a very small screenshot. The idea is that above is all the keys I'm going to use for the search, right? Basically, it's a key list, and I define the list, the information I want to show. It is artist, author, duration, summary, URL title. Okay. I'm using artist and author because it depends on the sources. There are some sources that use author, and other sources use artist, so I'm going to use both and just check what I'm going to show. And then below is the function to search. So basically the search is, the API is quite simple. Basically it gets the source, okay, the search source, which is the source I'm going to search. For instance, if I select YouTube, that's the source I'm going to use. It's a G object at the end. Then I have the text I'm going to search. For instance, the GUADEC. I'm going to see GUADEC. The below the search case actually are the list above. It's just a list of all the information I want to show. And well, the options, which basically allows you to control more how the search must be performed, right? I will show some examples later. And then the callback. Basically, it means that when you start the search, the callback will be invoked. Every time it finds a result, it will be invoked through this callback. So basically, you receive this, the media found with all the information you are asking for in these callbacks. Okay, so if I ask for 10 elements, I will receive, I mean, at least 10 callbacks or less if there are no such, you know, such amount of elements. Well, this is basically the search, and the browser is quite similar. I mean, the browser is exactly the same. It has the same parameters and mostly the same. So what you see is quite simple because I'm I'm forgetting or isolating the API for the web service. I'm making it more simple. I don't need to handle with REST or handle with XML or whatever. Everything is done by the Grilo. So as it is now, there are two problems, right, to be solved. The first one is that not all the information I want to show are handled by the source. For instance, well, in this case, in YouTube is done, but just figure out on a plugin of a web service that provides video but doesn't provide the thumbnail, right? Doesn't provide a thumbnail. So that's one of the problems we need to solve. What happens with information that is not provided by the source? Another example could be, for instance, if you are writing not with Totem, but you are writing at your set-top box application, you want to show the retro of a movie, okay? Probably you are browsing through your local disk and you have there your video, your movie, but you don't have it doesn't store the director. So how to have this kind of missing information? And the other point is about what happens with keys that are quite expensive to retrieve. An example is, in the case of YouTube, if you check how YouTube works internally, it means that, well, when you want to search for a content, you go to the web service, you perform the search, and it returns an XML with all the information, right? The problem is that information doesn't store the URL. In order to get the URL, you need to go to that entry, create a special URL page, and go there to get the real URL. So it means that, for instance, you are asking for to have 200 elements, for instance, instead of, if you don't ask for URL, it will only be one request, right? Because there, and download, but you ask for the URL will be 201 requests. The first one for getting the XML, and then one request for each entry, just to get the URL, right? And of course, that's quite inefficient because my application will be showing all the elements quite slowly, even when I don't want to use the URL. Right, because at the end, I don't want to show the URL. The URL, I want to use it later. So that's a problem. Okay, so basically, we'll help you in solving this problem just using some flags to control how Grilo should retrieve the content. So basically, the normal way of is just you go to, for instance, let's just put an example of YouTube, right? You with the normal flag basically goes to YouTube, it gets the content and tries to provide all the kids, all the information it has. So if there are some information that YouTube can provide, for instance, let's say a special key, that YouTube can provide, basically it will be empty, that key, YouTube can provide it. But if there are some information that takes a lot of time to retrieve, it will be retrieved anyway. So basically it means that, okay, I want these keys, all these keys from this source. Right. The second flag is fast only. Fast only means that, okay, it's like the normal way, but I'm telling the source, okay, there is some key that it takes too much time to retrieve it, please don't do it. And this, if it takes much more time, actually depends on the source, right? Why? Because, well, it's clear that going to YouTube is quite slower than getting the data from your hard disk. But the point is that from the YouTube point of view, getting URL gets more time because you need at least two requests to the service. Regarding the, for instance, other keys that only request one request. Right? So for instance, getting the artist, the title of the video, it means just one request, getting the XML, and enough. If you are asking for URL, or maybe for thumbnail, in some cases, some sources getting the thumbnail is something that requires an extra step. So to avoid to make the stuff too much slow, I just use the flag. Okay. And then there is the wonderful one, which is the full flag. Basically, full flag says, okay, I want to get this content from YouTube, but make all the possible, ask other sources if it's possible, just to fill all the information I'm requesting you. So it means that it's the case where all the sources cooperate together, like in the sample I showed in the beginning, all the sources collaborate together to provide information. So for instance, I'm browsing, let's say, not in Totem, but for instance, in media player application, I'm browsing Jamendo, and I say, okay, I want to show the title, the thumbnail, and I want to show also the lyrics. Jamendo doesn't provide the lyrics. So if you use the full, basically what the system is going to do is, okay, let's search who is providing this information. Let's make all the possible to provide this information to the user. So the user doesn't need to, to deal how to integrate all the information and do it by hand. It can still, if they want. But this provides a way of doing it. So how to use it, this? Well, the idea is, first of all, I'm going to use the search because it's the something that you can see in your laptop when you use Totem. The first thing is that I'm going to request content by chunks. If I can't request 1,000 elements, I just want to ask, let's say, for instance, 100 elements. At least some the elements that fits in my screen, right, to show them. So if the user scrolls down, I will request more information. So this way, I'm not making stuff so slow, asking for elements that maybe the user is not going to check. So that's the first step, first point. The second point is that in this request of the content, I want to show the information as fast as possible using the fast only. Why? Because probably the user can see the information with some missing fields, let's say for instance the thumbnail, but maybe he's not interested in this. Need information, we want to scroll. So what we want is not block everything until the operation ends. So basically, they say, okay, don't provide me these slow keys. Okay, so once this operation is performed, and if the user is not doing a scroll, let's do something in background, which is okay. Now, in the case of Totem, okay, I have this video which is visible. The user is seeing it in the side pane. So okay, let's ask for all the information that I didn't get from the previous content. So I do it, and I do the same for each element. But in the moment that the user scrolls, I stop doing it.
right? Because maybe that video disappears from the screen, so it doesn't make sense to get, for instance, the family because user is not going to see it. So it is done in background, right? The special case is the URL keys because actually we are not showing the URL in the screen. So what we do is the same, but when the user double click on the element. So when the user double click on the element and we check, okay, it has no URL, yeah, because it was already low key, so it was not provided before. Okay, now let's search for it, get it using the flag, so I can play it. So basically, this is a way of using the flags from Grilo, how Grilo helps you to integrate and handle the information that can be slower, faster. And basically, it's an algorithm that most of the occasions, when writing the media player and you are very concerned about the performance and about the UI responsiveness, you can use. Okay. Well. Let's see just an example how the full works. Okay. Basically, the full flag, or to know how actually Grilo integrates information. Let's say that I'm browsing, for instance, your local hard disk. Right, you have your content indexed, and there is a Grilo plugin using tracker. Right, and goes to use tracker to provide your information. Like you can provide from YouTube. It's just a plugin. So just think of you have your MP3 well tagged, but you don't have the thumbnail. Okay? So you are browsing with Totem. Well, with Totem not now because you only had the video, but in the past you could browse audio content. So just figure out that you are browsing the local content and you want to show the thumbnail. Okay. Thumbnail is not provided by that source. So how it works? Well, when you use the full flag, okay, what it's going to do is, okay, first I ask all the information to tracker, right? So I create audio content that has all the information that tracker knows. Now I check that and I see that, okay, thumbnail is missing. So what Grilo does is, okay, who is able to provide thumbnail? So basically it takes the audio content, this media audio which is created, and start to ask each one who can provide that key. So there can be three answers when you ask a source. It can be, okay, I can't handle this information, right? If you provide me a URL, this media, I can provide it. So, okay, you are discarded. The second one can be, hey, yes, I can provide you information. You are asking me for thumbnail, I check the media audio, I can provide that information, okay? I'm going to ask you then the thumbnail. So that source will integrate the thumbnail in the media audio, right? And in the end, the media audio is returned to the application that asked for the information. The third case is when this source can handle the thumbnail, but you know there is no so much information on the media to do it. An example is, there is a source that can provide the album's cover art, you know, and doing it means that it needs to know the artist and the album, right? So if it knows the artist, it knows the album, it can go, for instance, to Last3M and fetch there this information. So basically, it will say, okay, I can because I don't have this information. So what the core does is, okay, let's do in a recursive way, ask for the artist and for the album title, right? So if we go to the tracker and ask for it. I mean, if it's not there, okay, let's ask tracker, what is the artist name and which is the album name? Okay, now I have it, so I go again to this cover art source and ask, hey, now I have it, can you provide me? Yes, I can, or at least I can try. Okay, so I go, just the source goes to Last3M, it checks, oh, I have the thumbnail, I put it, right. If not, it can't, okay, I say, okay, I couldn't do it. Okay, let's try with another source. So this is done totally transparent for the user. Using this doesn't need to have this use case. So this is probably the Totem is the way of the most common way of using Grilo, right? Which is using the operations that Grilo provides to use them to get the content, searching or browsing. A different case is gnome-music, and I'm not going to talk about gnome-music, but about the relation with Grilo. So the first thing is that at this moment, gnome-music gets the content for your local disk, right? But eventually, it would like, you know, if you don't have your thumbnail disk, your cover art disk, get them from Last.fm or whatever other place. So this is a basic screenshot where it's showing there the album, the title of the album, and I think the artist. Right. So what's the problem here? As you say, it's only going to use one specific source, which is Tracker. Right? It's not going to use, for instance, Jamendo. Only Tracker in this case. Well, it's Tracker because we want to show exactly the title of the album and the artist name. So that's the Tracker can provide. I mean, we can't go to the file system already because that would mean, you know, to decode MP3. But at the end, we want to sort things, so it will be quite difficult. So basically, we are going to use the Tracker. So the problem here is that music actually defines its own structure. In Totem, if you check Totem, in the case of browse, if you check the tree that is created to browse, and basically that tree is defined by the source. A source defines the tree it wants to provide just to do the browse, right? But in this case, in case of gnome-music, we want to use our own structure. You know, we want to use album first level, and artist first level, and song first level. And you check the Tracker plugin, it doesn't provide that structure. It provides a different one. So that's our first problem we have. The second one is that you know, we don't have in Grilo at this moment, at least, the concept of artist of album. Basically, in Grilo, all the content that are not final content, you know, they are not audio or image or videos, are called boxes. Boxes like a container that you can browse inside and get other boxes or music. For instance, you can see, think in a box like an artist. You know, you have an art or an album. You have an album which is like a container that contains songs, right? So album is a box, and the songs are the Grilo media audio, right? So we don't have that that concept. And the other one is that, gnome-music wants to sort the results, but there are a lot of ways of sorting them, and the Grilo is providing doesn't suit the requirements. So this is an example of some of the screenshots to show all that information. You know, so basically, it's the first one is the albums, which shows only all the albums. The second one basically provides the artist, and then for each artist, provide all the albums. But you can't get that information from Grilo directly, right? Because it doesn't have that structure. It doesn't have the structure that if you browse through artists, you get the name of the artist, and if you browse through the artist, you get the name of the albums, right? And if you press on the album, you get the name of the songs, right? The Tracker plugin is providing a different one. Yeah, we can think, okay, let's change the structure to do that. But if you do that, then probably another application will have a very different requirements will not won't fit. So how to fix it? Well, there's actually two ways of fixing this. The first one is, okay, as I want to use my own structure and I'm getting the elements from Tracker, let's use Tracker directly, right? So I go to Tracker and use Sparkle to get all the music I want in the order I want, whatever, okay? That's fine. And in fact, GNOME Photos does that. It's use Tracker, to get the content, right, from that. So what happens with the missing information that we want to show? For instance, the cover art, right? Because we are losing that feature from Grilo. So one solution could be, okay, with this information, let's create a Grilo media manually, and then I will ask to Grilo, okay, I have this media, please provide me the cover art. I can do it, actually, right? So that's one way. The other way is telling Grilo, telling Grilo trackers how to construct the medias. Okay, so it would be great to say, okay, when I browse in the artist, please create me the content in this way. So I'm getting the albums. You know, I'm telling them, or for instance, I'm telling, okay, if you ask you for these artists, please, when you are create the artist, I would like that, it, for instance, the duration is the total duration of all the songs from the artist. Okay, so in Grilo you can do it. And this is a feature that basically short circuit the Grilo and goes directly to this web service. This is a function that called query, which is exactly like the search, but instead of specifying a text to search, you specify a query, right? So the problem is that this is quite very specific to the plugin. The query format is very specific to the plugin. So for instance, the UPnP source, it has a query where you can cook your own results, and the query language is basically like this UPnP language, DIDL or something like that, I don't remember exactly the name. In the case of Tracker, this is a Sparker query, right? So this query is basically, you pass this Sparker query that you were using above, okay? Instead of using above, I just pass to Grilo. And with this query, I'm going to tell, okay, how to create the content. So in this case, for instance, the in order to create content, basically, when I do the select of the columns, the first one I say, okay, I want this to be a video or a box, and then I'm going to map, okay, each column to each metadata key in Grilo. So basically, I'm saying, okay, the duration in Grilo will be this, the third column in this query. Okay, and then I have the query here. So in this case, other than that, it works like the other, like Totem. Once I ask query, I can use the full flag, so it uses tracker, it creates the elements, so it checks if some content is missing, and it adds it to the to this element. So basically, I'm not showing here an example because actually the Sparker query is quite big. I can't reduce it because it will fit the screen. But that's the idea, is that I use a Sparker query to get the content, and that Sparker is basically telling how to build the result. And other than that, it works like the way you know. So basically, yeah, this is very specific to the plugin, but at least it has a way of, okay, I know this is very specific, but I want to have the choice of, you know, fully exploit all the features that the backend is providing to me without using this common API that Grilo provides. So these are mostly the two use cases we are using right now, but there is, of course, another use case that you can use in your application, for instance. Let's say you are doing an application that you want to allow to upload content, let's say to a service like YouTube. So basically you are browsing your content in local and you want to upload it to YouTube. So basically there is a function which is basically called store, which means exactly like the browse function, but instead of getting content, it just upload content there. So basically with that function, you can implement an application that is able to provide content to store content on the web service. A different one is, for instance, the media player with auto-resume feature. You know, you are playing your song and you want to record or remember where the last time you were playing it. So basically, the usual way of doing it right now is, okay, I'm just playing, when I stop, I get the, you know, the, where is the checkpoint for the streamer or whatever, I store it in my local disk or my local database with the name of the video, so the next time I'm going to play it, I can recover it, okay. So, using Grilo is more easier, because there is a key in Grilo which is called playback interrupt time. Okay, so basically, if I want to show a video, I just ask for all information plus the playback interrupt time. And playback interrupt time contains the where should I resume the playing. So basically, I'm playing it. Now I need to update it. So update means that I'm going to this media, Grilo media. I change the value of the playback interrupt time and use a function which is basically quite simple, which store metadata to store that information. So basically, the way it works is, okay, it will use all the sources. For instance, maybe the playback is not available in YouTube. For instance, you are playing a video from YouTube, it's clear that playback interrupt time is not in YouTube. What happens is because it's storing in the local hard disk, in the database, which is another plugin which provides information, like IMDb, but in this case provides the playback interrupt time. And from user point of view, it doesn't matter. It's total hiding. So basically, is what it's going to do. It's going to take this key, update the database. So next time it recovers it, we have the new value, right? So basically, these are some use cases that you can do with Grilo. There are quite a few more, but I mean, this probably for me is not enough. So, yeah. So, just to end, this is a full example of an application. Grilo is writing in Python using the introspection bindings. And what this application does is, you know, I want to create a PLS list with my favorite content. So basically, this program, you specify a system, for instance, you know, Metallica or whatever other artist, and it searches all the audio content in all the sources available there, you know, in Jamendo or in your local disk or in UPnP. It checks in all the places, and this creates playlists, right? And it's only 28 lines, okay, including some comment there. So the main parts are in the line 14, defines the information you want to store. Okay? This is basically in PLS is a duration, title, and URL. Okay. Then in line 18, I'm using these options, like mentioned before, just to store how many elements I want. Okay, I'm restricted to 200. And then I use this function, which basically means search in all the plugins which are there. Okay. The result in this case is not a synchronous function in this case, it's a sync one. So the result is a glist. So for each element, I'm just checking, okay, if this media is an audio, I print it, getting the duration, getting the title, and getting the URL. Right, so when I run this program, I basically create a playlist. And as you see, I don't care about if it's YouTube, Jamendo, or whatever. Okay. So I put here some of the resources that you can use. We have the wiki, we have source code in Git, GNOME. We have also the code in GitHub and GitHub. So you can clone it, work further. We have the IRC or channel and basically the mailing list. So that's all. And if you want to ask something.
Hey, basically I saw that Debarsh had a good progress on gnome photos, and I really want to know if you think you can use I can use the same mechanism Debarsh in the same way that Debarsh did the implementation to support RDO or Spotify on Grilo.
Well, there is I mean, there are some kind of sources that right now, at this moment, we can use in Grilo. Special one are the radios, the radio contents, because when you are browsing, for instance, the UPnP server, you get a bunch of content, and there is no restriction about start playing it at one element, and then play the next, or play the previous one. Don't have any restrictions. You can play in order you want. In the case of things like Spotify, the point is that first you only can get just a small window of the what songs are going to be played. And what you can do is, I can play one, but I can't play the previous one. Or I can skip one, but not going back. You know, this, you can only go forwards in the time. So right now we don't have a way, I mean, you can do it, you can implement a plugin, but the point is that you are not telling the user, hey, you can go back, because there is no way of doing it. So probably it will be require some new concepts, maybe like Grilo radio stuff or something like that, that specify, okay, this is a radio, you can go, you know, you can play it, but once you start to play it, you can go back, or you only have a very small window of how many elements you can ask for.
Yeah, I got your point. Okay, thank you.
Welcome. So, no more questions. Thank you very much for your attention.